Today we are going to save. Well, let's change the idea a bit. Today we are going to spend. Spend what you like, Carlos. Just 35 euros to take the internet with us this summer. And I'm not talking about 35 euros a month for a data plan. No, I'm talking about the simplest way to set up internet on our boat, which for 35 euros will cover the majority of the needs of almost any vacationer. Because today we are going to see how to install a super affordable and durable router on our boat, well, motorhome or second home or whatever it may be, which for 35 euros is designed to work outdoors and with which we have managed to achieve connection speeds of 20 megabits 18 miles offshore. And if we complete it with the cheapest data rates, we're talking about less than 10 euros a month for unlimited data, you're going to be amazed. Can you say fall on your butt?
Yes.
Aren't you going to give me a pee?
No.
Are you sure? Greetings sailors and welcome to a new episode of the Low Cost Sailor. In today's episode we're going to look at a Chinese router that I bought for less than 35 euros, which works excellently, is designed to be installed outdoors, and how by doing just that, installing it outdoors, we can gain a lot of coverage in areas with coverage issues or when we venture out to sea. A very flexible solution, and if we complement it with some of the cheapest rates on the market, it could be the ideal solution for having internet on board. We've already talked a lot about the advantages of having a connected boat, so today I'm going to talk about what could be the ideal data plan for us based on our needs, and how for 2 euros a month we can keep the boat always connected to monitor it from anywhere. Or if 2 euros seems insignificant to us, for 10 euros a month we can have unlimited data to monitor the boat, but also to watch Netflix, Amazon Prime, or even football. Well, you all will watch soccer, not me, but for watching soccer. This thing about you not liking soccer is false. I have graphic images of you watching a Spain match in Ibiza, I think it was. And there you were, going crazy, singing the goals.
What happens in Ibiza stays in Ibiza.
It's true. Sorry, 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 sorry.
Summer arrives, the time to disconnect, to go on vacation, to sail, to anchor in some paradise, to enjoy life, and to forget about the rest of the world for a while. The moment of turning off the phone is probably the best form of vacation, but for some, completely disconnecting is a bit out of reach, especially from the internet, because nowadays we use the internet for everything, we work with the internet, but we also communicate, get informed, and even entertain ourselves with the internet. But thanks to the internet, my work has become much more flexible, and now from the boat, I hold video conferences, connect to servers, solve problems, or even write scripts for my YouTube channel, or upload and edit a short, those that you see.
Anything but sailing.
I do everything on the boat except sail. Let's not kid ourselves, the internet has been coming on vacation with us for a long time. Throughout our episodes, we have seen the importance of having Wi-Fi on board as a means to connect all the equipment on our boat, such as cameras, plotters, sensors, tablets, and mobile phones. And there has also been some confusion between having Wi-Fi on board, a local network for exchanging information between devices like traditional nautical buses such as NMEA or SeaTalk, and the difference between having Wi-Fi and that Wi-Fi also being connected to the internet. This allows us to stay connected to the world when we are on the boat, but also when we are not on the boat, thanks to having internet on board, enabling us to connect to it for monitoring purposes. The simplest way to have internet and even Wi-Fi on board nowadays is to share the connection from our mobile. Almost all of us know how to do that. This, which is extremely simple on all modern phones, enables a Wi-Fi network with an internet connection that we can use with other devices like a tablet, a computer, or a smart TV. It's simple but a bit cumbersome from the standpoint that we have to be on board ourselves or leave the phone on board, and it uses up our data and battery. Another way we've seen to get internet from our early episodes is to mooch off the neighbor's Wi-Fi. That's how I had it until recently when I was at the port, connecting to the port's Wi-Fi to have internet and repeating it on my own Wi-Fi inside the boat. When I wasn't at the port, we also saw how with a 3G or 4G USB dongle and a SIM card, I could have a connection and automatically switch to using it when I went out of the port's Wi-Fi range. And if I move far away from the reach of the port or even the reach of civilization, we could use Starlink to connect from any corner of the planet at speeds like home fiber. The truth is that I really like that solution, and it's undoubtedly the best, even the only viable one if you're crossing, for example, the oceans. But let's not fool ourselves. For most sailors who barely leave territorial waters and only venture a few miles from the coast, and the most we do is cross to the Balearic Islands, the solution of installing a good 4G router outside can provide us with connectivity on our voyages at minimal costs. Because sometimes we use a sledgehammer to crack a nut. We say that 100 megabits of bandwidth is little and we end up getting the 1 gigabit. In reality, 100 is more than enough. Rarely, if ever, do you fully utilize the speed of your home internet, because, for example, to watch Netflix in 4K smoothly, you only need 15 megabits and just 5 for full HD. Let's look at the solution I currently have on board, with which I can get up to 20 megabits 18 miles offshore. What I have purchased to provide internet to my boat is an outdoor 4G router, specifically the QWi-Fi 4G outdoor router for €33. It is designed to be installed outdoors, is IP, mine has been exposed to the elements for months, has a couple of antennas, but it has connectors to attach other antennas if necessary. It is designed to be mounted either on a wall with its base or on a pole or tube with brackets, which is how I have it mounted. It features Wi-Fi, two Ethernet ports, a SIM card slot, a 12-volt power jack, although it can also be powered by PoE at 24 volts. In fact, the power adapter that comes with it is a PoE adapter, meaning it uses the Ethernet data cable itself to connect to 220 volts. Regarding the internet part, it's a 4G router, so we can expect speeds of up to about 50 megabits per second. And here some of you might ask, why a 4G and not a 5G, which is what's trending now? Well, first because of the price, since €35 is a gift for a device with these features. And second, because of using a sledgehammer to crack a nut, as I've seen speeds of up to 400 megabits on my 5G phone. The problem with 5G is that it is much faster than 4G, but its range is much shorter, and offshore, what will provide coverage is 4G, not 5G. You will also need an Ethernet cable. And if you want to power it via PoE directly from the boat's battery, which is how I have it, then a PoE adapter, about €1.50, a regulator to increase from 12 volts to 24, less than €5, and a connector to connect these with the PoE device, another €2, but actually for a pack of 10. So in total, with everything, you won't spend more than €50. Well, and you would need a SIM card to provide internet. Of course, the key here is to understand our needs, because we have talked about bandwidth, the speed of the connection, and we have already seen that we didn't need much. Another thing is the amount of data per month that we will need depending on how you will use the internet. On board, you have two very economical options, and now I'm going to talk to you about rates and prices in Spain, and I imagine in other countries it might be quite similar. What is most evident for many is to request a duplicate of your mobile SIM to be able to use it in another device. Many of you do it, and in reality it's not that cheap because they usually charge you a fee for the duplicate card, which can be quite a bit more expensive than any of these other proposals. Because if what you want is to monitor the boat when you're not on board and you have, like me, cameras, bilge sensors, gas sensors, remote switches and those kinds of things, and you want to control everything when you're not on board, my recommendation is to get a card with 8 GB and 120 minutes of calls for €3.50 a month, though you'll have plenty of minutes left because you'll be putting it in a router. Even after you have enrolled, you possess the ability to modify the plan in the subsequent month, eliminate the minutes and retain 8 GB of data for €2. Furthermore, if you surpass the limit, the speed is diminished, yet even with the diminished speed, it remains sufficient to connect to the boat and at least receive all the notifications or activate or deactivate anything on the boat. This has been the option I've had for years as a backup for the port's Wi-Fi when I was sailing. I've always been very happy, but recently I discovered and decided to try another option because the Wi-Fi at my port was getting worse. So I decided to get a real flat data rate with unlimited data. That's how I discovered Allo Mobile, with a prepaid rate of $9.99 per month, which you can contract month by month or year by year. And in this case, it's even cheaper because it's $99.90 for a full year. Although there is some fine print, like the reasonable use of data, if you exceed between 200 and 600 GB per month, they may consider it unreasonable use, but I tell you, it's quite a lot. Then there's another limit, which is 10 GB per month when you're roaming around Europe, but that's something almost all companies have. It also indicates that it's for use on mobile phones, but anyway, I've been using it for 3 months without any problem with the router. I haven't held back at all in terms of data consumption or anything, and it has worked perfectly for me. In fact, I've consumed 160 GB with an average of 65 GB per month with no problem. I will leave the hyperlinks in the video description section and on our website post, because if you register through my provided link, I receive an additional month for free. And what is there that I like more than free? Nothing, nothing. The installation is very simple. First, insert the standard sized SIM card, ideally deactivating the PIN with a mobile phone before inserting it. But if not, the device itself will ask for the PIN when we configure it. Now, to install it, the first thing is to find a place on the exterior of the ship to install it. It should be as high as possible and with the antennas as clear as possible. We will see that the height will help improve both the speed and the distance offshore where you will have coverage. Ideal places to install it are at the top of the stern arch, on the shrouds, or at the top of the mast, as these are very good locations for it. The device comes with a cover with integrated connectors and cable glands to keep the connection stable. Ideally, as I have done, you would connect an Ethernet cable to one of its ports and, through its cap and the watertight rubber, run the cable into the interior of the boat. A single cable will allow both data and power to pass through. My recommendation is to connect it to a small router inside like the one I have, so you can have a separate Wi-Fi inside. But you connect the same cable to the PoE connector and this with the voltage regulator to the boat's battery and you have it powered. The detailed diagram would be this, which is also available in the post on the website. The configuration is very simple. It has a web interface where you can set it up. You'll need to use a computer or a tablet to do it. But if you leave everything on automatic, and if you have removed the PIN from the SIM card, everything will work without doing anything at all. Well, normally you would connect to the default Wi-Fi it creates, which will be named wireless, followed by a serial number with six letters and numbers, and it will have the password 12345678. All of this is listed on the sticker on the device itself. Even so, you should change a few things. To do this, enter the router address 192.168.1.254 in a browser, and at the very least, I recommend changing the administrator password in Advanced Settings System Admin Account, where you can change the password. You should also do the same with the Wi-Fi name and its password in the section General Settings, Wireless 2.4G, and with that, you will have your Wi-Fi with internet on board that will work perfectly with internet access and ports you can use to connect wired devices. But if you want to be a pro like me, my recommendation is to disable the Wi-Fi that comes with the router itself and set up a small onboard Wi-Fi router like I have, as we saw in one of our first episodes. The best part arrives, the moment of testing, because of course we had to see how well this internet worked and how far we could go with it. The initial tests were at the port, and of course, the improvement compared to the 3G dongle I had on board is more than evident, even though the coverage at my port is very poor. However, taking the router outside improves the situation significantly, providing between 10 and 30 megabits of bandwidth. And usually from here I have conferences with him without any problem, many conferences with Carlos from work and such, blurring the background to make it look like I'm in an office, but really I work a lot from here. But in the port it was easy. So the next step was to test it while anchored. And what better than to leave the port a little, find a nice spot, and conduct my tests while I took a dip in the water. The result was the same, but it was much more enjoyable to take a swim, eat while anchored, and watch something on Amazon Prime or Netflix. But I couldn't stop there because I knew you would all ask me how far this internet could reach, so the best excuse to get up, set sail, and start navigating out to sea to conduct my tests was that. I sailed out of the Bay of Santander already under sail, started venturing into the sea, what a day, how the wind was blowing, and everything kept working. Sailing at almost 6 knots, I ventured into the sea, verifying that I continued to get good results, although I must say that the speed is somewhat worse when you're near the coast compared to when you move away. The performance through Wi-Fi is lower than through cable, but still sufficient to watch Netflix in full HD while browsing. The thing is, there was such a strong wind that I couldn't even watch Netflix or anything, it was just sailing. And so I kept going until I was about 3 miles offshore and realized that if I tried to reach the limit that day, especially with the changing wind that wouldn't stop shifting, I would be in big trouble at home for arriving very late. It started blowing really hard, so I turned back. When I entered the bay, it changed to south, and as soon as I reached the middle of the bay, it stopped completely. My objective is to achieve a distance of no less than 15 miles. However, how could I accomplish this? I required an exceptionally swift vessel to reach those distances with speed. What could I think of? Until I saw the Salvamar passing by at full speed. What a great idea. Taking advantage of a coverage test I had to do with Maritime Rescue for another device, I boarded the Salvamar out to sea to try to find the limit. And the truth is that we found the limit relatively soon, but not because it was close, but because we were going very fast, at more than 21 knots cruising speed. Up to about 17 miles, almost hitting 18 miles offshore. The speed was even more impressive than near the coast, holding a steady 20 megabits, which was quite stable. But once we passed the 18 mile mark, it suddenly dropped to zero. And this is entirely normal because essentially, if we take into account that the antenna we were utilizing is considerably elevated in Peña Cavarga and the router was positioned 4 meters high on the Salvamar, our calculations for the line of sight with the curvature of the Earth result in approximately 18 miles, which aligns with what we had observed. So more or less, that's where the limit will be, depending a bit on the height of your coast and where the antenna you're using is located. All of this assuming that the Earth is spherical, of course. If you are flat earthers, don't worry, it will reach wherever you want. Well, you see, I might be a bit obsessed with it, but having internet on board seems essential to me, and having the ship continuously connected, it seems very important to me because of all the opportunities it opens up with sensors and such, and because nowadays we live, entertain ourselves, enjoy and communicate, and everything happens through the internet. So, it seems fundamental to me, especially when you consider that in the end, it costs almost nothing to set up a router for 35 euros, have a rate of 2 euros or 10 euros if it's an unlimited plan. It's very cheap, it's highly recommended.
And what's coming? It left me amazed. 18 miles is quite a lot.
The 5G would start to cut out around 4 or 5 miles and the 5G would start to falter. My mobile, which was inside, stopped working at 11 miles and was already connecting through the router's Wi-Fi, of course, because in the end, the elevated antenna works much better. I am very happy with it. And about the speed, well, nowadays we do have gigabytes of speed. Hundreds of megabytes are not so necessary. 5 megas crossing the Atlantic is watching whatever you want on Netflix. It's awesome. Thank you so much for your attention, sailors. I sincerely hope you found today's episode enjoyable. If that is the case, kindly give us a thumbs up, subscribe to our channel, and click the bell icon to get notifications whenever we release a new video. You have all the links both in the video description and in the post on our website, www.thelowcostsailor.com. If you need to stock up your boat with anything, take a stroll through our online store. We have plenty of items, and we are constantly adding more things to our online store. And if not, we are sincerely and genuinely quite grateful to you, especially to a select group of individuals who provide us with unwavering and steadfast support, who are our esteemed and valued Patreons. They will now be displayed here on the screen, and we could not possibly be more thankful for their support, which enables us to continue creating videos. Thank you. See you in a couple of weeks in a new episode of The Low Cost Sailor, and I have to go because I'm running late and they're going to scold me. Run! Let's hurry.